always the same question. What am I going to wear? Fine and elegant, a wild pattern, or rather inconspicuous tone in tone? Animals seem to have it easier than us humans. Nature provides them with their outfits. Armor for fighting, a feathery collar for seduction. Broad snowshoes so as not to sink in the deep snow. Each animal wears the perfect clothes, it seems, but it's not that easy. Animals also have problems dressing up. They too follow the rules of fashion and must pay attention to their appearance. There is an abundance of predators in the African savannah. Those who cannot run away or hide must take other measures to protect themselves. Extravagant and unique, this protective suit. The African pangolin resembles a walking pine cone and trudges across the ground like a dinosaur. But it is actually a mammal covered with scales made of keratin, just like fingernails growing all over its body. The scaly shell is ideal to squeeze through thorny bushes, especially when this is the shortest way to breakfast. And like every other day on the menu, ants. They carry seeds as their food, but will turn into food themselves any minute. Their scent gives them away. Long claws expose the ants. And an even longer tongue pulls them out. The whole pangolin is adapted to catching ants. Eyes and ears, even the nostrils can be closed tightly. Not even the termites in their strongholds are safe. Pangolins break in anywhere. And in return, what could ever happen to them? A serval, a rare wild cat. Pretty, long-legged, and curious. Something is going on over there on Termite Hill. Pangolin is deeply immersed in the insect hunt. Everything else seems of no interest. And yet it moves on soon. The termite population shall recover quickly until the next visit, a normal routine. But now, an unexpected encounter is about to happen. And quickly pass. Curled up, the armored pangolin cannot be harmed. The horny scales make it impossible to get through. Not a chance. Not even for lions and other big cats. A scaled dress seems perfect, but it needs to be maintained and cleaned as well. A 40-centimeter long tongue can come in quite handy. It can reach almost every scale, especially when lifting them up just a little too. But that is not enough. From time to time, the pangolin needs a thorough cleaning. Preferably wet, with abrasives. The sludge has to find its way under each and every scale, especially on the back, which is hardest to reach with the tongue. And how does one get rid of all the dirt? Simply with a rinse. Then the armor shines as new. And yet a serious disadvantage remains. Armor like this is heavy, making the wearer hulking and slow. But it does not have to be like that. Now, at low tide, the tide pools at the North Sea become a refuge for nimble armored animals. Underwater, the weight does not matter. Everyone knows them. Shore crabs. On the inside, they are as soft as rubber, but they hide behind solid armor. Eight legs, also armored, with hinged joints. Openings for the telescope eyes and the olfactory antennas. And not to forget, the pincers. Powerful weapons in the fight for females. The strongest competitor has the best chance. It might even lose a leg or a pincer, but they simply grow back. The hard carapace protects against the worst enemies. Too bad that it has to be put down every now and then. If they have outgrown their carapace, they need a larger size. They must molt. And that can end in disaster, because the new shell is still soft at its beginning. And crabs are cannibals. They shred every carapace that is not yet hardened after the molt. Crab meat, as fresh as it gets. No one wants to end like this. Like this young crab female. She is about to molt. Her shell feels too tight already, but then she would be defenseless against such pincers. What to do? He has already picked up her scent. His antennas report a female which will soon be soft and weak. He rushes in, grabs her, and drags her away. Escape seems impossible. But suddenly, a twist. The female ceases to fight back, hugs him almost tenderly. And he, bewitched by her scent, thinks only of mating instead of munching. Reproduction takes precedence. But to mate, she must hatch from her shell dress, otherwise it won't work. Tenderly, he massages her legs. Their molt is particularly delicate. He tests her carapace on the back to see whether it has already loosened. The cannibal turns into a noble knight, who is willing to fight for his beloved. And she also clings to him, follows her protector at every turn. Until it is safe again. Attack averted. Now the right time has come to remove her carapace. She pumps herself full of water. She swells and in that way breaks apart the stomach and back armor. and he supports her gently to undress. Her seductive smell turns the rough cannibal into a tender partner. Done, the old clothes can be discarded. Yet the new ones are still too soft, making her vulnerable. He waits with mating until she is a little more stable. All in all, life behind armor is not easy. And yet, chitin shells are the models for success from nature's closet. All insects and beetles wear them, including Hercules, of course, the muscle man amongst the beetles with his formidable pliers. The female can safely do without this scary accessory, because Hercules wears his giant pliers simply for one reason: to impress her and her peers. They want to be taken by storm. A nocturnal tournament is about to happen. The opponents have taken up position. Presentation of arms. Everyone is trying to intimidate their rivals. Who throws the decisive pinch? Who manages to tip over the enemy, take him down? The effort is worthwhile because it is about the ladies. Clear victory by a classic shoulder throw. His armor has absorbed the impact. He will get back on his feet. But he shall rule over the branch now, and his girl is waiting. Owning armor to wear is good, but which is the best? Welcome to the armor showcase at the pond. This is pond life as we know it. The pike is the great predator, but even the smaller pond dwellers hunt and eat. Water fleas as prey in dense clouds. They resemble mini crayfish, no bigger than a peppercorn, protected by a hard shell, a tiny armor. They move by rowing through the water with strong strokes. But now things get uncomfortable. A swarm of sticklebacks has appeared and has an easy time. They swallow the water fleas in one piece or suck them out. All the remains are spat out again, the empty shell. Defenseless tiny crabs? Not quite. They can smell their enemies, and with each molt they improve their armor. They acquire a helmet with a pointed tip and a longer tail. And now, the fish have something harder to swallow. Pricks and stings in the stickleback's mouth. A bite that will not go down easily. And rather wants to keep swimming outside. Also, the long tail is now in the way. Tailored protective suits against sticklebacks. And what to do against voracious swimmers with their proboscis? A few molts, and a shield has formed where the proboscis just slides off. Water fleas adapt to their enemies. This armor is supposed to help against the larva of phantom midges, which now cannot properly get hold of the water flea. The motto is to remain flexible when it comes to fashion. There is no question about it. Tough clothing can be helpful, but not everyone can wear it. The fire salamander would suffocate. Like all amphibians, he breathes through the skin. It is thus thin and vulnerable. But what if a potential enemy shows up? With sharp teeth and spikes, roaming through the forest in search of prey. Such things do not trouble him at all. His skin is covered with poisonous mucus. And that is being conveyed, clearly visible from afar, by its striking warning costume. Black-yellow means do not mess with me. Behind the eye on yellow background sits a battery of poison glands, and the rest of the body is covered with them as well. The salamander seems to be aware of that, acting all self-confident. If necessary, he uses his secret weapon. Poisonous jets from two glands on its back. Black and yellow costume, the young hedgehog will learn to read the warning signs in the future, a simple lesson in the language of fashion. It does not necessarily need sounds. Colors and patterns can speak louder than words. Let the clothes speak. The little tree frog, for example, relies entirely on camouflage rather than a warning costume. Green frog on green ground. Hard to spot. But there are also branches in the tree, which are known to be brown. So it starts to change colour. And minutes later, the tree frog has turned into a branch frog. And when it sits on the trunk, into a bark frog. And if it is still discovered, it will rely on the final rescue jump. The masters of camouflage can be found underwater. If they are found at all. If you dress like the environment, your fashion statement says, I am not here. A crab in seaweed costume, so overgrown, its enemies will have a hard time finding it. This outfit also speaks for itself. Squids can simply disappear. They merge perfectly with the ground. They sway with the swell, and not even the eyes are particularly noticeable. They are giant cuttlefish, squids with 10 arms that can change their appearance within seconds. not only colours and patterns, they also put on bumps and ridges. No one knows yet what they want to express that way. What do the daring tips on the back mean? Are they secret messages? But for whom? Some emphasize their eyes, makeup of a different kind. Giant cuttlefish seem to have developed a keen sense of fashion. Very elegantly, they glide through the water, mostly backwards. If they are in a hurry, they blow water out of their caudal tube. Recoil principle in action. Otherwise, they produce gentle waves with the edges of their fins. Once a year, the giant cuttlefish have their grand appearance at the Spencer Gulf in Australia. There, they come together in their hundreds of thousands in search of a mate. The large males seem to be bursting with strength, half a meter long and up to 10 kilos in weight. The females, built gracefully and dressed differently, with two beauty spots on the back. They keep their arms folded down, as if they were shy. Quite different to the macho with his powerful arms. His bright colours reflect inner excitement. He has discovered a female, which is hiding under a rock. She shall be only his. From now on, he will defend the hiding place. No other male is allowed to get too close. Quite a task, but manageable, as long as the rivals are smaller and weaker. But now, a stronger rival moves in, a worthy challenger. With pulsating rings, it signals its willingness to fight. But only on the side facing the enemy, the other side remains peaceful. Like two battleships, they line up alongside to compete, including eye-catching colors meant to intimidate the opponent. And suddenly, the decision is made. A short brawl, 20 thrashing arms, and the intruder takes to his heels. Our macho has made it clear whom the female belongs to. But he might be mistaken. Not far away, a male is coming out of hiding. Pretty measly and without chance when it comes to mating. But the little one knows how to help himself. He disguises himself as a female, letting his arms fold obediently. So he sneaks closer, sweet, kind, and female, so it seems. The lurker in drag. And then he boldly slips into the female's cave. Without objection. After all, it's only another female. Wrong. The two find themselves quickly, the lurker and the sepia. Secretly, they become a couple. Head to head, he hands over a sperm package, mating, cuttlefish style. But at some point, their affair becomes too obvious. The macho gets suspicious. The cover is blown, and the lurker is up for a beating. But too late. He has already passed on his genes. Sometimes pure strength is no match for cunning. When the cold season begins, everyone should dress warmly. Or not. The yellow sequined gown of tiny scales does not protect against the cold. It does not have to. The brimstone butterfly is poikilothermic, as are all insects. It assumes the temperature of its environment. It can even freeze completely, down to minus 20 degrees. Antifreeze inside the body makes it possible. Quite different for those who have warm blood. The task of their clothing is to keep the warmth in the body. A thick winter fur for the red fox, urgently needed because again and again he has to go out into the snow. Hunting mice. The mountain hare also has wrapped itself up against the cold, even in matching colors. And not to forget the winter shoes with fur trimming. Extra wide soles in order not to sink in the deep snow. Those who have missed the latest winter fashion draw attention to themselves. All clear. The great grey owl is content with a mouse snack. It too flaunts the latest winter collection, including down boots. A rare and endangered species in northern Canada, mountain caribou. Their winter coat looks rather thin, but the hairs are hollow and insulate especially well. They are on their way up to their favorite feeding grounds high up in the mountains. Good thing they have wide hooves. Just like wearing snowshoes, they stay on top without sinking deeper. And then the goal is reached. The lichens in the trees, usually too high up out of reach, but now with the high snow and snowshoes, easy game. Nothing compares to nature's clothing. Even for a night out, the choice is huge. Lovers of the night have their very own fashion. Some flaunt a daring pilot suit. Others wear clothes that seem a little crazy. There are actually butterflies dressed in fur. How absurd. This moth has a fur coat. This death's head hawk moth has hair everywhere, even on the head. But what for as a poikilothermic animal? It provides the answer itself. It trembles before the start in order to warm up, which means it ramps up the aircraft engine with the wings disengaged. That way it reaches operational temperature. The thermal camera reports 40 degrees, exactly the temperature needed for takeoff, and the fur keeps the heat inside the body. Another perk for some moths. Their fur is a clear signal to bats that they are inedible. When ambushed in midair, there is another survival trick up its sleeve, head-on dive. Just brilliant. Skull Airline. Tender green, the first flowers, time for alluring spring styles. He dazzles in his iridescent peacock robe. The peacock's hens are more modest. They are being courted. ...150 long feathers with the famous peacock eyes, impeccably arranged in regular circular arcs. A fashionable piece of art and signal for perfect health. The presentation even has its own soundtrack. That's how the peacocks court their females. And it's ladies' choice. A few false feathers and their value as a mating partner decreases dramatically. A splendor of colors and feather headdress, they all show what they've got. And he who dresses best attracts the females. But the fashion show is also about competition. Those who cannot keep up lower their masterpiece and withdraw. Pretty feathers pay off. Spring fashion also makes its appearance amongst the frogs in the marsh. Yet they are all brown in colour when they move in thousands. For mass mating. Who? With whom? A wild mess. In their mating frenzy, the male frogs turn blue. Probably to avoid confusion during the mass mating. Simple Moorfrog's rule, if it's blue, don't be a fool. Only what is brown counts as mating material. Blue uniforms can be ignored to save time and energy. Only with females can they produce offspring in spawn. Spring is the time of special editions. These birds seem to know that very well. They are ruffs, who now in May fly out to their northern breeding grounds. All dressed unpretentiously in speckled brown and white for the journey. But this will change. And after the trip, one has to freshen up, and the males have to put on new clothes. Down with the feathers on the neck, a new collar is needed. It is already beginning to show, and then in full splendor. Each male dresses up differently, even with a feather wig on his head. fashion made for seduction. But the courtship suits are also combat suits. Running and fighting with short breathers. Everyone wants to grab the best place to present himself. To impress the female sex as a fast and agile fighter. The females, in the meantime, keep calm. They only want the most beautiful, strong, and elegant partner. Not everyone can convince them. In June, it's all over. Everyone wears their simple everyday dress. A change of clothes may change more than just the appearance, especially among anthias living in the coral reef. The males wear reddish purple with golden scales. The attire of a harem ruler. Constantly in motion, he keeps his harem together. No one shall stray too far. In her orange dress, the females are difficult to differentiate. But one of them, the female on top, bears a scar on the back, a kind of badge. Her hour is yet to come. The grouper is dangerous, but so what? A spurt back to the coral and they'll be safe. Likewise with the predatory mackerel. But this threat now is more serious. An armada of lionfish. Flashy as he is, it will be him above all they set as their target. Lionfish are masters of the ambush. They wait patiently for a chance to attack. And it will come. He catches the eye, venturing too far out. The end of a harem ruler. What will become of the females? Without a protector, no one to fertilize their eggs. Now the scarred female's time has come. She is the largest among the ladies of the harem, and she begins to change her clothes. A first hint of black and purple. A few days later, she is almost unrecognizable. Dark blue fin hems, the orange displaced by red. And her movements are more restless, just like the males. After about a week of changing, the makeover is completed. One minute dressed in female orange, and now a magnificent male. Only the scar reminds of the former sex. And as it should be, he produces sperm, providing its females with offspring. the new boss of the harem. The only question is, for how long? When will another one of his harem ladies slip into man's clothes and replace him? New clothes, new sex, transforming fashion made by the Antheans on the reef. The purpose of fashion in the animal kingdom seems to be survival. But who knows? Maybe some animals know the notion of pure pleasure of great clothes for no apparent purpose. Bearded vultures are eligible candidates. The largest birds in Europe with a wingspan of over 3 meters. In the Pyrenees, they search the slopes for dead animals. And they even take pleasure in a lean carcass. They are the only birds that eat bones. If not itself, then a competitor. Flashy beard, red circles around the eyes, and a fabulous swallowing capacity. But even more unusual is their crazy sense of fashion. They love to dress in a certain color. Again and again, they take on long flights to find their special beauty parlors. Secluded puddles with ferruginous mud. Ideally suited to change the color of their white plumage. Rusty red, it has to be. Other colours do not come into question. They proceed with the utmost care and complete dedication, it seems. Looks better already. Never before has the recolouring been documented in the wild, and it is a complete mystery to ornithology. What is the purpose of the rust-red colour? It does not protect against parasites. It has nothing to do with the rank among the birds. It is not related to the sex males and females indulge in this luxury treatment. So why the effort? Maybe it's just a fad with which the bearded vultures override any dress code. Hot summer day. Even the cows at the lake seem a bit limp and lazy. Those who can now soar across the cool water with a fresh breeze are well off. Or even better. But not everyone can simply go for a dip when it's too hot. What do rabbits do if they get too warm? Or roosters, or chickens? And last but not least, the cows at the lake. How do they keep cool in this sweltering heat? Dressed in a warm fur or feather coat. No wonder they prefer the shade. Cows have far fewer sweat glands than humans, and under the fur, the sweat cannot evaporate either. The cooling effect is low. But their noses are not huge and bald for nothing. In hot weather, they are well supplied with blood and let off heat. In the thermal image, the nose is bright red because it radiates heat. Just like the almost hair-free areas around the eyes. They also contribute to cooling. And of course, the bare udder, the hottest place, the cow's hotspot. Furred fashionistas use their bald spots to get rid of excess heat. Rabbits use the same trick. Their fur is thick and they cannot sweat at all, but they have long ears that are hairless on the inside. In the hot weather, the warm blood shoots through the veins in the ears and cools down. Long ears for listening and cooling. Supported by the eyes and the rabbit's face. And the most important measure above all, to move as little as possible in this heat. They face the same problem. The plumage isolates. What to do with the excess heat? The only naked areas on their bodies are the heads and legs. In the thermal image, they almost seem to glow. Chickens as hotheads. They're hot spots via which they give off heat to the outside. The chickens belong to organic farmer Michael. He is prepared for such a hot day. Bare skin gives off a lot of heat, and unlike his dog, Michael can sweat. 10,000 sweat glands sit on his forehead alone. Evaporation has a cooling effect. Dogs do not sweat. They cool through panting when the humidity of the tongue and palate evaporates. Smart replacement for the missing sweat glands. Fur and transpiration seem to be mutually exclusive, but there are exceptions. Every rider knows horses can sweat vigorously if they feel hot. They are born runners, also because they have developed an effective transpiration despite their hair. Ideal for running long distances without overheating. Horse sweat is a special juice. You can see it when the horses are rubbed dry. Then it starts to foam. The sweat contains fat-removing tensile, a kind of detergent. That way it can penetrate the hair to the outside and evaporate, cooling the horse. Smart clothing, specially made for horses. And also for their striped cousins in Africa. The pangolin, on the other hand, can only dream of such luxury. Sweating, impossible. But instead of sweat, it uses other liquids. For example, the saliva on the tongue. And urine also evaporates. A few droplets on the bare belly, what a relief. Especially when distributed all over. Without question, nature is trying its best when it comes to clothing. But everything has to take action too, not only when it comes to cooling. You have to know how to put the clothes in the limelight. One has to be comfortable in their own skin. Each style of clothing requires the appropriate behaviour. What's the use of armour without the capability to change it? What's the use of winter clothes if you missed the point or time to put them on? Or spring clothes without the art of seduction? Clothes alone are not everything. You have to behave accordingly. Only then will all the wonderful creations come to fruition and facilitate survival.